Hello everyone, I'm the Dorky Deviant, and welcome to my review of Waifu Blade Chronicles 2.
That's not the title of the game.
What do you mean that's not the title of the game?
It's not.
Now see here, I read on the internet...
Stupid.
No, you're stupid! That's it. Welcome to my review of Xenoblade Chronicles 2. Well guys, the grind through Xenoblade Chronicles 2 and Torna the Golden Country was a 260-hour endeavor. It's the most time I've ever spent with one single game, and I loved every second of it and didn't want it to end. It feels like I could have kept playing this game forever. I'll put it to you like this. If I was trapped on an island with only one game, what would it be? This was one of those games. I will start out with saying that this game is an event, and that should be no surprise considering the Xeno series has a long history of grand narrative and ambitious design. It's a top 3 game series for me. But what made this game so eventful is how the scope of everything it encompasses is so massive, from the huge environments to the depth of the game systems to character tuning, and this lore-packed world set on a complicated political stage. It's like everything was designed with a massive scale in mind. The game begins with you playing the role of Rex, the teenage chosen one from a small town who has a big heart and is a salvager of the mysterious Cloud Sea. He sells the trinkets he excavates to make his living and lives his life by the Salvager Code. One day he gets an offer to come along for a very important and high-paying salvaging mission, and what he finds and the events that unfold on this mission sets up the story for the rest of the game. You then proceed on an adventure of epic proportions, with one of the recurring themes seeing the cast question the rules that govern the universe and everyday life and why those rules work the way they do. The world of Alrest is the most mysterious one and is the setting for this game. Alrest consists of multiple titans, which are gigantic living creatures that exist as the continents of this world, with all the inhabitants literally living on. Each titan has its own race, culture, and geography. The game does an excellent job of fleshing out these things, and the game world is huge and full of exploration, which is the highlight of the Xenoblade games. As you would think, the attention to detail in the overworld environments is staggering, and the art direction is incredible, and assists in achieving the immersion of this huge world and exploration. It's a match made in heaven. The characters range from bad to good, and in a couple of the villains' cases, great. But all in all, I would say the cast is slightly above average for a JRPG, but some of them fall into the generic tropes and feel a bit like you have seen them before, which I don't personally mind, it just doesn't add much to the experience. Then, to add to this problem, there's a lot of generic JRPG dialogue outside of the main cutscenes, and it's pretty obvious it's an area where corners were cut, meaning the writing isn't super memorable, and sometimes your party members all feel like the same character, but fortunately the main cutscenes are much better. I guess you could say the writing is fine when it counts the most, so I'll give it a pass. The villains are actually better than the main characters in this game. Malos and Jin, who is totally a husbando, are very complex and have complicated pasts and motivations. So if you like some nice villains, Xenoblade 2 has them. Now on to my favorite character. My favorite character is Poppy. She is a newly awakened robot, so she has a childlike curiosity and questions about people and living and the world around her. Desumo. She has the most complex and obvious evolution and character development of them all, and especially so if you do her side quests and get her upgraded form. You actually see her go from adolescent to teenager to adult. My runners-up are Rex and Pyra, as they're the main couple in the game, and their romantic thing is very cute. Rex is slightly more realistic than a normal chosen one teenage JRPG protagonist, but a lot of adult stuff goes over his head. But his drive and willingness to help others is contagious and makes the others in the group want to journey with him. I like Pyra because she is Rex's ride or die and her commitment is admirable. She is actually the lesser of the two main ladies, but I still prefer her because she's always ready for what's next and willing to go the distance. Pyra is the best girl, top tier waifu of this game, without question. And guys, there are tons of gorgeous waifus in this game. You have Pyra, Mithra, Brigid, Azami, Vale, Agate, Newt, Nim, Korra, Dahlia. And those are just some of my favorites. Waifus galore. The game's recruitable characters are called Blades. There are 51 fully designed optional Blades and some generically designed common ones that you can recruit to your team. Your main characters are what's known as drivers and can equip these Blades to fight alongside you like a JoJo stand. And give you stat boosts and even have their own equipment and skill trees. You obtain Blades from core crystals, which you will find all throughout Alrest. Then you awaken them with one of your main characters, and a random Blade joins your team. This is also known as a gacha system. The core crystal and Blade system is a huge part of the story too. Blades are like living weapons and declare loyalty to the driver that awakens them. Drivers are scattered all over Alrest and have a special talent from the rest of the world's inhabitants with the ability to resonate with core crystals and awaken Blades. The game really starts to shine in the later half when the revelations and secrets start to be unveiled. However, the entire journey is filled with lore and world building, which is really nice. There are tons of history and important events and legends that are told, and it's very well built. These things are heavily expanded upon in the side content, so let's go ahead and go over that now. There is a massive amount of content in this game and questing. Let me first say, I didn't even do all the content in this game, and it's not uncommon for someone to spend multiple hundreds of hours in order to 100% it. And the game rewards you handsomely, in many different ways, the more time you put into it. Questing is broken down in two forms. You have your regular quests, which are the traditional quests you would think of, and then there are merc missions, which are essentially quests that take place in the background of the game and are on a timer of varying duration. You send out squads of your extra Blades to partake in merc missions, which net them experience, gold, and unlock nodes on their skill trees. Speaking of skill trees, there is another way of unlocking the nodes. Each individual node has an unlock requirement listed next to it. Requirements can range from doing an ability a certain number of times, killing a certain amount of an enemy, using specific items, etc. Each node's requirements are almost like many side quests themselves, and when you take these and hundreds of merc missions in addition to the regular quests with how many potential Blades you can get, you begin to see there is a staggering amount of content and things to do here. And remember those 51 rare Blades that can join you? Well, all of them have their own story quests and cutscenes as well, with many of them having other side content to keep you busy with. So much content. The gameplay is like a MMORPG. And battles are similar as well. You control one of three characters and it takes place in real time, and you can move around your enemies for positioning and strategy. Your characters perform auto attacks, which fills your arts gauges. Your arts are mapped to the B, Y, and X buttons. Basically, there are a number of gauges and cooldowns as you build up toward pulling off the ultimate attacks and combos. Battle is very, very deep. Your end game is to perform chain attacks that pause the action and let you do special abilities with all three of your characters and their blades for max damage. It takes a while to get used to and understand. There's a lot going on in battle, but once you wrap your head around it, it's extremely deep and rewarding. The battle system is a nice upgrade from Xenoblade 1, and the combat selections are spread out across the different systems this time. Instead of having to select abilities at the bottom of the screen like in Xenoblade 1, they are mapped to their own dedicated button. And thus, Xenoblade 2 really cleans up the selection and timing aspects of battle. I've really never seen a battle system with this many layers of progression to use the ultimate attacks. It's very developed, perhaps even too developed. It's not exactly for novice JRPGers, but since it's so unique anyway, I think the learning curve is pretty similar for everyone. There are a few nitpicks, mainly the blade collecting gacha system may not be for everyone, the blades you get are left to chance, and it's a huge time dump to get them all, and there are a few even rarer ones where the chances are even less. Cosmos. The blade management is very clunky and annoying, and there are a finite amount of blades you can carry, and it fills up quick on your quest for getting the rare blades. The game doesn't allow you to dismiss a blade immediately after awakening, so you have to manually dismiss them from the list, which is a headache. And just the menu in general has way too many screens and options, and you'll get lost at some point along the way trying to find what you need. You just have to stick with it for these things, and it could have been smoother, but it doesn't really take away from the overall experience. The game's downsides really dance around the line of what's acceptable, so they aren't too bad. Now let's get into the music. This game has phenomenal music. Like its predecessors, Yasunori Mitsuda has overseen the music. With Ace and Kenji Hiramatsu returning from Xenoblade 1, and Manami Kyoto also composing, they got to do a lot of special things with the soundtrack of this game. There are the melodic orchestrated tracks that you would expect, but there are also some incredible vocal songs and a few surprises. The OST has a nice array of instruments, while the music feels very atmospheric and fitting for the on-screen imagery. Now let's tackle Xenoblade Chronicles 2, Torna the Golden Country. This is an expansion done right if I've ever seen one. First of all, it actually got a physical release and wasn't just add-on DLC, and that's fitting because it's basically a whole other experience that tells the story of the Aegis War 500 years in the past from the main game. It shows what some of the blades from the original were up to and explains some of the loose ends left in Xenoblade Chronicles 2. The game is a tweaked version of the original. Unlocking core crystals is gone, you have a fixed amount of blades, and has been changed so you can switch between your driver and blades during battle and on the field, which I loved. Many systems have been swapped out, and the menu woes cleaned up and simplified. One of the standout aspects is how underdeveloped the world of Allrest was 500 years ago, so you won't find as many big bustling towns and areas, and it's a more rural and backwoods experience. There are only two titans to explore, however, one of them being a brand new one not seen in the original. Also, this game's characters are better. Since you don't have a plethora of blades to unlock, the game can really focus on the main characters, but this bunch is just more well done if you ask me. I give major props to Nintendo and Monolith for doing this incredible expansion. They didn't have to, but it's really just another 40-hour prequel game with some borrowed elements. I would definitely check out Torna the Golden Country, and I recommend playing the original game first, seeing as it's the main experience, then tackling Torna after. It also works better from a gameplay progression standpoint, given the changes made. But if you really must, you can play Torna first, but I would save playing Xenoblade 2 in chronological order for later playthroughs. In closing, these games really hit their marks in multiple directions. It's a sum-of-its-parts experience, and it really put the feels and nostalgia on. They really took me back to a great place that I hadn't visited in way too long. This is one of the best gaming experiences I've ever had, and also one of the most fun and addicting ones. I absolutely recommend this. It's one of my favorite JRPG series, and Monolith is at the pinnacle of JRPG development. The wagon wheel of this game's systems is an achievement in gaming all its own. It feels like literally every system is connected or impacts one of the others in some way. Everything builds on one another, and the game is balanced and designed like a well-oiled machine. This is not one to miss. Well, this was a long one. I really appreciate those that stayed for it all. I wanted to do justice to this review, and hopefully I've done that. I didn't get to all the points I needed to make, but I just couldn't fit everything in because there's just so much to this game. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed it, and thanks for the view. I'll catch you later.